Big shadow haunts opposition vice presidential candidate Alva. Our 2016 interview sparks fire. Alva on camera slamming the Gandhis.
Why did you say during elections, Margaret, you're supposed to be close to me? So I told her, I said, ma'am, if I have embarrassed you or you're upset.
BJP asks, vice presidential nomination, a peace deal. Our top focus on India Today.
Margaret Alva's nomination as the opposition's vice president candidate has become a bitter pill to swallow for the Congress party. A 2016 interview that she gave to India Today has come back to haunt the Gandhi family. In the interview, Alva had alleged that the Gandhi family had links to VVIP chopper scam accused Christian Michel and his family. The BJP is now asking if Alva's nomination for the vice president's post is a peace deal.
Hours after being declared as the opposition candidate for the vice president's post, Margaret Alva's 2016 interview to India Today has come back to haunt the Congress and how.
I am no one to say so. I don't know the relationship between them. All I'm saying is this is on record of Parliament.
Absolutely. And your story.
It was a debate in Parliament.
And your story raises the question, you can't answer it, but your story raises the question, did Christian Michel inherit his father's links? Your story establishes that his father, Wolfgang, had clear links to CPN Singh, possibly to Sanjay Gandhi, maybe to Indira Gandhi. Did Christian Michel inherit them or not? Christian Michel denies it, but it's possible he may have. Let's leave that aside. Your story is interesting because it raises that possibility.
Dropping the bombshell on the VVIP chopper scam, Margaret Alva even accused Sonia Gandhi of taking party decisions in an arbitrary fashion.
Observers were sent. We were in Bombay and the observers claimed they had met the MLAs. And this was the opinion, which we knew was not, because we also knew what the opinion of the MLAs was.
So it was being engineered to suit someone's personal decision.
Yeah, it was decided, and so this was the way in which it was announced.
And the General Secretary, the sitting Chief Minister and the PCC Chief were neither consulted nor informed?
No.
The BJP was quick to target the Congress, asking if Margaret Alva's vice president nomination was a peace deal.
Margaret Alva's interview to the India Today asked the group a few years ago has created quite a controversy today. She had alleged several serious allegations against Sonia Gandhiji. Either she was right about it and Sonia Gandhiji has accepted those allegations as being true, or to the contrary, Sonia Gandhiji's Margaret Alva's allegations were incorrect at that time and she has rescinded from them.
The presidential elections have already exposed the opposition fault lines. With Margaret Alva's nomination too, TMC and Aam Aadmi Party are undecided so far. But the opposition is presenting a united front.
Now in the year 2022, when opposition unanimously suggested her name to be fielded as the vice president's candidate for opposition, Sonia Gandhi's approval is also there. So what is the media trying to find out?
Margaret Alva will file her nomination for vice president poll on Tuesday. And though the numbers are stacked against her, Alva's nomination is a bitter pill to swallow for the Gandhis. Bureau Report, India Today.
India Today's interview from back in 2016 with Margaret Alva has become a big political talking point. This interaction done with Karan Thapar has now gone viral on social media, where Margaret Alva didn't just drop a bombshell on the VVIP chopper scam, but also exposed the functioning of Sonia Gandhi as the party president.
You weren't consulted on critical decisions and you were general secretary, not an ordinary person.
But this keeps happening in all the parties. You do think it doesn't happen in other parties? It's happening everywhere.
You have three very striking examples in your book of the arbitrary ad hoc way in which Congress makes appointments to critical positions. The first, was after the 2004 elections in Maharashtra, you were General Secretary in charge of the state, Sushil Kumar Shinde was the sitting Chief Minister. And this is what you write in your book. To our shock and dismay, the name of Vilas Rao Deshmukh was announced as Chief Minister. Shinde, Rao, the PCC President, and I had not been consulted or even informed.
That's right.
It literally happened behind your back.
Two observers were sent. We were in Bombay, and the observers claimed they had met the MLAs. And this was the opinion, which we knew was not, because we also knew what the opinion of the MLAs was.
So it was being engineered to suit someone's personal decision.
Yeah, it was decided, and so this was the way in which it was announced.
And the General Secretary, the sitting Chief Minister, and the PCC Chief were neither consulted nor informed?
No.
There's a second example in your book, which in some ways is even worse, about how Congress arbitrarily comes to critical decisions about appointments. It's about how Sushil Kumar Shinde was appointed Governor of Andhra Pradesh. You write, he had not been asked, but simply informed. And proof of that is with you. He was sitting in your home having tea in Delhi when he got told he'd been appointed governor.
That's true.
So the man wasn't asked whether he wanted the job.
No, I think informally Mrs. Gandhi had said, well, I'll send you to some good post. You can go as governor. And she then took the decision. She doesn't take the decision. She recommended it to the Prime Minister. Same thing happened in my case.
Absolutely. In fact, in your case, it's Mrs. Gandhi who took the decision, because this is the third example of the arbitrary ad hoc way in which Congress appoints people to critical posts. In your case, when you were appointed governor after you resigned as General Secretary, it happened one afternoon when you were asleep. You got a phone call from Sonia Gandhi and you write, before I could reply or refuse, the phone call ended. In other words, she literally told you, Margaret, you're going to Uttarakhand as governor, and put the phone down.
She didn't tell me I was going to Uttarakhand. She told me, Margaret, I've recommended your name for a governorship.
And the phone went dead.
Phone went dead. I didn't want to leave Delhi. I sort of wanted to say, ma'am, why? But I didn't get an appointment after that either.
And no chance to talk on the phone either?
No.
So it was a 30-second conversation to tell you you're being appointed a governor and nothing more?
No. And then Chidambaram rang me up, of course. He was Home Minister.
This particular story also proves that critical decisions like appointing governors were taken by Sonia Gandhi.
Whatever the differences, he was the Prime Minister. He had been the Prime Minister. He had been Congress President. He had been Chief Minister. He had been Party General Secretary. You know, and he had done a wonderful job, whatever you may say, wherever he worked, except for Babri Masjid and the mess up with it. But the question was, when a man is dead, you don't treat him that way. And I was hurt. In fact, I've always regretted not walking away on that occasion, but I didn't want to insult his body by walking away.
At the time you were General Secretary, and at that time you were very close to Mrs. Gandhi, she had personally brought you back after your defeat in the 2004 elections. Did you ever raise with her this treatment of Narasimha Rao?
I did not. I was very hurt. And I didn't discuss it with anyone, though I did say to my colleagues that this is not the way to treat a dead leader. Most prime ministers had their cremations in Delhi, had something, his body was sent to Andhra. And they said that he was a chief minister, great leader of Andhra, and he should be.
So he wasn't even in death given that honor of a burial or of cremation in Delhi.
You're right.
Voting for India's next president officially kicked off today. And while it's all but certain that Draupadi Murmu will be India's next president, the entire process of nomination has exposed the massive fault lines within India's opposition, which seems to be at this moment in complete and total disarray.
A settled affair favoring a ruling dispensation in general. But this presidential election is not much about the NDA, whose candidate looks set for a smooth sail to the Rashtrapati Bhavan. It's rather a testament to the ever-widening fault lines and broken relations amongst non-NDA parties. A A camp that lost an opportunity to at least make a bold political statement of unity before the Lok Sabha elections barely 20 months away. The BJP-led NDA's choice of a tribal woman candidate for presidency threw a fragile opposition into disarray. On the same page with the rebels who unseated them from power just recently, the Thackerays in Maharashtra have announced their support for Draupadi Murmu.
पहली बार हमारी एक महिला भगिनी आदिवासी समाज से देश का जो सर्वोच्च पद है उसके ऊपर विराजमान होने जा रही है तो मैंने भी यही सोचा कि सारे लोग अगर प्यार से मुझे कुछ कह रहे हैं तो उनकी भावनाओं का आदर करना चाहिए.
And so did the TDP in Andhra Pradesh. A friend turned foe of the BJP down south. A former governor of Jharkhand, Murmu has also secured the support of the JMM, an ally of the Congress party. After all, tribal communities make up 26% of the state population. They quit the NDA over the farm laws in 2020. 2 years later, and in the wake of their crushing defeat in the state assembly elections, the Akalis chose to stand beside the NDA candidate in the presidential vote. She set out to build opposition consensus over presidential elections. An effort mired in discord from the word go. The first three names proposed for the contest declined the offer. Former Union Minister and veteran Yashwant Sinha officially named as opposition candidate for the presidency.
Don't disturb me today before they announce the candidate. They just ask us that what is your suggestion? They appreciate that and you give your suggestion part. Should we consider also? Because we can discuss it in the meeting also, opposition party meeting. But it was not there. That's why I am also feeling sad sometimes because our contest is going on. Though we know that Dr. Murmu chance is better now because of Maharashtra, the development and all.
But days later, the architect of the elusive opposition consensus put him in an awkward spot as she softened her stand on the NDA's contestant. A candidate left abandoned by many within the opposition ranks. And an opposition that looks far from fighting the 2024 general election in unison. Bureau Report, India Today.
The Congress drawing heavy fire for picking Margaret Alva as its vice presidential nominee. Now remember, here is a candidate who has criticized the Gandhi family, Sonia Gandhi and Indira Gandhi, in interviews and in books, and somehow she's the one who gets picked. This coming on the back of the opposition together, deciding they wanted to back Yashwant Sinha for president. Again, somebody who had the choicest of things to say for the Gandhi family and for the Congress party. Why can't they find a proper candidate? And what does this say about supposed opposition cohesion in the build-up to the 2024 Lok Sabha elections? Joining us on this broadcast, representing the Congress, its spokesperson Charan Singh Sapra. Squaring off against him, Shehzad Poonawala of the Bharatiya Janata Party. For perspective, I'm joined by Rajdeep Sardesai, our consulting editor. Rashid Kidwai joins us. He's written a fine piece this morning on Margaret Alva's selection for our website. We've got Rahul Srivastav, our national affairs editor. Charan Singh Sapra, let's go to you. Explain, given the fact that she's been in and out of the party, given the fact that she's had an acrimonious past relationship with Sonia Gandhi, given the fact that she's publicly questioned the Gandhi family and its dealings, including in defense contracts, why then was someone like Margaret Alva your choice for vice president? What do you have to say about this blast from the past India Today interview now going viral?
See, Rahul, the answer to your question is that democracy is alive in Congress party, and every Congress leader, you know, is from the same democratic setup, and they can voice their concern whenever they wish to. I feel in today's situation, the more than 30 opposition parties, they have collectively sat together, they have deliberated on various candidates, and they have come to the conclusion, including Congress, that Margaret Alva ji should become the vice presidential candidate. So I don't see any harm in it. And neither any Congress leader has objected to it. Whatever views you are talking about or whatever views are going viral on the social media, I feel those are things of the past. And being a democratic party, everybody has his turn to speak.
Rajdeep, this is democracy in action in the Congress. No congressman has objected. The likes of Shehzad Poonawalla and the BJP are objecting, but they would have objected to whoever the Congress would have put. Given Karan Thapar's interview, given all that's written in Rashid's book and his article this morning, given her past positions in the Gandhi family, why then did the Congress pick Margaret Alva as its vice presidential candidate?
You know, firstly, I read Rashid's piece and I've watched Margaret Alva's past interviews. I've read her book. I think we are exaggerating that they have an acrimonious relationship between the Alvas and the Gandhis. Don't forget, Nikhil Alva, Margaret Alva's son, has been very close to Rahul Gandhi, has been part of his media team now for several years. Margaret Alva herself was chosen by Sonia Gandhi to attend the canonization of Mother Teresa when Sonia Gandhi was unwell. When Margaret Alva lost the 2009 elections, she was made a governor and became a governor in three different states. So I think it's a bit of an exaggeration to say they've had an acrimonious relationship. I think some of the comments that Margaret Alva made in her autobiography obviously stung the Gandhi family, alleged links between the Augusta Westland lead deal and the Congress family. She has, even in the late 1970s, broken away in a way from Indira Gandhi and joined hands with the Devraj Arz group for a while, was close to Sharad Pawar, the person who we believe yesterday promoted her candidature. So you could argue she's had a mixed relationship with people within the Congress, but I would say she's remained by and large what you would call a Congress loyalist. And therefore, I'm not surprised that given the bankruptcy of options within the opposition, I think that's really the issue. The fact that the opposition today seems to lack those kind of imaginative choices that they may well have had for both the president and vice president, they've chosen octogenarians who've been in politics for decades rather than look maybe for someone who could have excited, if not the opposition ranks, knowing that the election was a dead certainty, but at least civil society. At least people who would have become talking points. So I think that's really where the focus should be. To my mind, Margaret Alva is from a state like Karnataka that goes to the polls in about 8 months from now. Minority member. I believe the opposition wanted to put forward a minority at a time when the BJP doesn't have a single Muslim candidate across both houses of parliament. Try and make some kind of a point. But eventually, you've chosen a safe candidate rather than someone who might have, in a way, as I said, galvanized civil society into becoming some kind of a talking point. The numbers are heavily stacked in favor of the BJP. So it's a done deal in that sense.
Shehzad, yeah. Rajdeep argues it's not as if they've had a terribly bad relationship. They've had ups and downs. Charan Singh Sapra says this is democracy in action. You can't criticize Modi and stay in the BJP, but you can criticize the Gandhis and still get picked as the Congress's vice presidential nominee. What's wrong with that?
No, look, first of all, making a virtue out of a necessity has become the traditional hallmark of the Congress party. But look, on the one hand, look at the candidates for president and vice president of the Bharatiya Janata Party and the NDA. We have history in the making, the first tribal woman president who is going to be elected to that position. On the other hand, the vice president candidate comes from a Kisan background. He comes from tough socioeconomic circumstances, rose to the top in the legal and constitutional field, defended the constitution in West Bengal. And that is the kind of candidate we have. On the other hand, now, what Mr. Sapra is dismissing off as allegations of the past, these are very serious allegations. I watched that entire interview time and over again. The tank scam where Indira Gandhi has been indicted. You had the first family's links with the Augusta Westland scamster Christian Michel, and the fact that his family has links with the Gandhi family, Wolfgang. She's referred to a parliamentary debate in which all of this has been mentioned. Apart from that, she has also made an allegation of selling of tickets in Karnataka in 2008. So I don't know how she is a great pick, but that is
their prerogative to pick her. But here is what I want to say. I agree with Rajdeep partially, but Rajdeep has only said half through. It's not just bankruptcy of candidates, it is bankruptcy of ideas. Rajdeep's good friend Jairam Ramesh, from the last 4 days, look at what he has been up to. One day it is about national emblem, fake news peddling on that. Then it is about the alleged word ban list. Then it is about the alleged dharna ban. And today you have this picture that was put out by Mr. Jairam Ramesh, where he's saying, can you, candidate kaun hai? Now I have a question for my dear friend Charanjit Sapra. This is a picture where Sonia Gandhi, presumably she, because she's the elector and the proposer of VP, then VP Hamid Ansari ji, is giving the thing to the nomination papers to the returning officer. I would like to ask, candidate kaun hai? This is the level of intellectual bankruptcy when it comes to the Congress party, and this runs deep. And now finally, look at the contradictions and the convenience. It is politics of contradiction and convenience. Yashwant Sinha was accused of being involved in UTI scam by whom? Digvijay Singh. They wanted a CBI inquiry against him. Chidambaram ko bada fraudster kisne kaha? Yashwant Sinha ne. This only because they wanted to spite somebody, they made this person who has almost all his life had a BJP track record and RSS track record, or at least BJP track record, not RSS. They made him the candidate and they pushed him forward, and look, they did not even go around campaigning for him. I mean, Rahul Gandhi was abroad, I believe. I'm not sure where he was. But Mamata Banerjee said that, you know, if we would have known Draupadi ji is the candidate, we wouldn't have. She never invited him to West Bengal. Jharkhand, where they have an alliance with JMM, dumped him and they said that we will choose somebody who's from the tribal
community. It's complete bankruptcy.
And just to make matters worse, they go ahead and they start insulting the candidate. They called her evil. And this is not being said by me. The JMM MLA, Mr. Nalin Soren, he objected to the Congress calling her evil and said, I'm going to take action against this. They called her rubber stamp, dummy. This is a person who has risen up from the ranks. She was a clerk. She went up. She contested elections, won the best MLA award. She served as a minister and the longest serving governor of Jharkhand. No easy feat, because she maintained the relations between Rajbhavan and
Rashid Kidwai. To call this contradiction and convenient is one thing. The fact is that Margaret Alva has had a contentious relationship. She's been in and out of the Congress. She's been in and out of favor. In her interviews and memoirs, when she writes her book Courage and Commitment in August 2016, she's saying all kinds of things about Congress's connection with Augusta Westland scam accused Christian Michel's father, Wolfgang Michel. Why then was she picked? Is it just a complete bankruptcy of choices and ideas?
I think, Rahul, from the beginning, it's that Congress has been very half-hearted. As far as Gandhis are concerned, you didn't see them attending any meeting about selection of candidate of whether presidential nominee or vice president. The announcement also came from Sharad Pawar, and supposedly he and Sitaram Yechury, etc., had proposed. If there is a Congress nominee and if she's Margaret Alva, then the Congress should have been far more proactive. I don't read much into what she has written, because she has a right to learn and live. I mean, she's within her rights to whatever she wants to say. And the Congress had a opportunity to showcase itself, that look how the BJP is looking for a kind of someone who's a loyalist, someone who doesn't speak up, somebody who would not have a very kind of critical view of the functioning of the government, etc. And whereas Congress has got somebody who's been a dissenter, who said things, who spoke not only against Sonia Gandhi or Indira Gandhi or Rajiv Gandhi, but against Narasimha Rao. Number of things I have put that, you know, she spoke against Narasimha Rao and she said all kind of things. So that's, it was a case of missed opportunity, I would say, with the Congress. Congress could have showcased itself by owning up Margaret Alva's candidature.
Shehzad, respond to that point by Rashid Kidwai, that it's not as if you only have to say good things to be in the good books of the leaders who matter. You could have been a dissenter, and yet the Congress gives you space, which wouldn't happen in the BJP. Look at what you did with Yashwant Sinha. Look at how Subramaniam Swamy is out in the wilderness.
Rahul, then, you know, I can even cite my personal example. All I said was, let's have an election in the Congress party. They did not need to throw me out from the Congress. And they would have kept all the other dissenters, including the G23. How many of the G23 members have been given proper accommodation or space to speak their mind in the party? So, you know, Congress preaching about tolerance and democracy is like Kim Jong-un and Kim Jong-un's family preaching about democracy in North Korea. I think nobody buys that. And if they were so democratic indeed, then they should come out and tell us what is their stand on those people who dissent with them in the party. So, but they have taken action on those who have dissented with the high command.
But what the presidential elections and the vice president's nomination shows is the fact that the opposition is in complete disarray, Rahul Shivastav. And many would use these elections to argue that if they can't even pick a worthwhile candidate, how in the world will opposition parties come together to try and declare one candidate per seat, which is what's been spoken of but never done in the 2024 elections against Prime Minister Modi and the BJP? And does that then mean that 2024 is a done deal?
Rahul, 2024 is far, but the fact is that one, when we discuss Margaret Alva, I think the story is much beyond what is emerging. You see, somebody who has been had a bittersweet relationship got mended, I think, when Mrs. Alva's husband passed away, Rahul Gandhi had visited her. So there was some kind of amending offences. But the fact is, as Rashid said, perhaps the most critical line now is, it is not the Congress which picked up the Congress person as a candidate. This is a repeat when Pranab Mukherjee was picked up by Mulayam Singh Yadav. The Congress was not interested. It waited for something which never happened. And it is Sharad Pawar and Yechury who made it fait accompli for the Congress party. That Margaret Alva will be the candidate, whatever political messaging may happen in Karnataka or wherever. Some people say it is perhaps because there was nobody else ready to lose contest a losing battle. Margaret Alva might have said yes. Now, come to the story of the president election, Rahul. Congress does not have its weight or have the pelf now. It is Mamata Banerjee and TRS who decide who is going to be the presidential candidate. So the Congress again loses out. So the principal opposition party does not decide or has no strong say in the decision on the president or the vice presidential candidate in the country. It wants to challenge Prime Minister Narendra Modi in 24 and the elections, assembly elections before that. The Shiv Sena is a part of the troop which goes with the Mr. Yashwant Sinha to file the nominations. If you recall, if you take out the pictures, the Shiv Sena members were there. Shiv Sena is voted for Draupadi Murmu. The Jharkhand Mukti Morcha is an ally of the Congress party, has voted against the against the opposition choice. You see the multiple levels of disarray. The NCP member in Gujarat has voted for Draupadi Murmu. You have Akalis voting. You see the crisis, Rahul, is the principal opposition party has lost tremendous space in this last 2 months, I think, on these two elections. Beyond that, the cohesiveness of the opposition is totally in disarray now. No, the question...
But the bigger issue here, Rajdeep, seems to be that the Gandhis don't seem interested in taking the lead and shaping an opposition view on how to take on the BJP. Rahul Gandhi was holidaying once again. Some who are keeping tabs at his fifth holiday just this year. I don't think you or I together would have had so many holidays this year. And you've got a situation where both the president and the vice president choices are choices which have been foisted on the principal opposition by much smaller parties. What does this say about the big battle of 2024 in your view?
You know, until now, it seemed as if the Congress was marginalized in its battle with the BJP. Now it appears that the Congress is getting slowly pushed to the sidelines or is at least having to compete for space even within the opposition. Even within the opposition, the politics, the day-to-day politics is being done by the likes of Mamata Banerjee, Sharad Pawar, and others, and not by the Congress. Who is there within the Congress to do that kind of day-to-day battle that you need to become the primary opposition party? Today, the Congress has 88 MPs between the two houses, which is substantially higher than either Mamata's party or Sharad Pawar's party. And yet, Sharad Pawar's party or Sharad Pawar himself or Mamata Banerjee seem to carry greater clout or seem more involved in these decisions. It was Mamata who took the initiative to try and evolve a consensus around the presidential candidate. That it failed is another matter. Again, in this instance, it was Sharad Pawar and Sitaram Yechury who thought fit that let's at least try and give a challenge to the BJP on the vice president's election. They tried to come across various names. I'm told Dr. S.Y. Qureshi, former chief election commissioner, was among those suggested by Mr. Yechury. He declined. Then Mr. Sharad Pawar suggested Margaret Alva's name. So to my mind, what is clear is that the Congress and indeed the Gandhi family
don't seem to be able now to establish their primacy even within the opposition space. And therefore, leading up to 2024, the question will remain, how are you going to find any kind of opposition unity and who is actually going to lead the opposition? That is an open question, because now at the moment, there seems no cohesiveness, no element of planning when the opposition could have used the presidential elections in particular, where the margins, remember, were much narrower. Vice president election is a done deal. BJP alone has 395 MPs in a 588 member electoral college. But in the presidential elections, where the margins were narrow, there could have been an attempt to find that kind of figure who could at least bring the opposition together. But the opposition singularly failed, threw up various names, most of whom refused to join in initially. And I think the limitation, therefore, Rahul, of the Congress becoming a magnet for the opposition are revealed as a result of what has happened.
You're saying the Gandhis are struggling to assert the primacy of the Congress in the opposition. I want to take that one step further by asking Charan Singh Sapra if they're even trying. Rahul Gandhi vacationing once again, completely disinterested in taking the lead, making the calls, building the connections. In the absence of Ahmed Patel, the Congress seems completely directionless, rudderless, uncertain of where to go, unable to even find a candidate who would do the Congress some proud. You've appointed Margaret Alva. People are questioning her comments against the Gandhis. You picked Yashwant Sinha, the likes of Shehzad Poonawala giving you a full chart sheet of what all he said about the Congress and what the Congress has said about him. You can't even get a basic candidate right, let alone trying to challenge the might of the BJP, Modi, Shah, Yogi, RSS all together. It's a no contest.
See, Rahul, generally the trend in Indian politics, whenever we have seen the presidential elections, even when we had elections of Pratibha Patil or Pranab Mukherjee, we have seen that the ruling party nominee or the candidate gets more than 4.5 lakh votes, and the opposition leader, whosoever he is, whether it was maybe Sangma or somebody else, they got below 3.5 lakh votes. So this
you,
is how
you know
the
you
trend
use this as an opportunity
there.
To bring opposition no. parties together. Your own ally, the Shiv Sena, your ally, the JMM, are picking Draupadi Murmu. Forget the BJP's allies. Even your friends are picking your opponents.
Yeah, so similar case was there when Congress candidate was Pratibha Patil or Pranab Mukherjee when Shiv Sena voted for the Congress candidate, or when Nitish Kumar also did the same thing. So let me bring this to your notice that this has been happening on various occasions. It's not happening for the first time. Even when Congress was ruling or UPA was ruling, similar was the case. So what I'm trying to say, in the current scenario, the way Narendra Modi and Amit Shah or the BJP government has, you know, throttled democracy by demolishing governments in Maharashtra or Karnataka or Madhya Pradesh, the way they have snatched Madhya Pradesh government. So there's a continuous process in which the democracy has been throttled. You know, Modicracy has tried to prevail upon democracy, and this is why they are now at an advantageous position. But definitely,
Shehzad Poonawala, respond to Charan Sapra. In the past, your allies, JDU, Shiv Sena, have also voted for UPA nominees for president, and therefore it's no big deal. It doesn't show the opposition is in tatters. 2024 is a different battle, says Sapra.
First of all, you know, it's not a case of Modicracy versus democracy. It is about Congress being crazy about Modi. This craziness for one person is the reason for half of their ills. They just can't get over this phobia of one person. Now let me explain to you. Today Rahul was making a very insightful point. The BJD, we are the principal competitors against BJD, right? In Odisha, but correct, they have voted for us. We are principal competitors against Uddhav Sena in Maharashtra. They are voting for us. We are principal competitors against JMM in Jharkhand. They are voting for us. And we don't sit on arrogance ki hum 100 saal purani party hai. Even a person like OP Rajbhar was contacted at various levels by the candidate
and by our other leaders, and we respectfully requested all of them to come together, because this we consider as a historic moment. This is the people's president. APJ Abdul Kalam was one of our picks. Then we had Ramnath Kovindji and now Murmuji. So they can say whatever they like. 60% of our cabinet is SC, ST, OBC people. Our prime minister is from the OBC community, the longest serving OBC prime minister of this country. They can make all these allegations, but we thought that this is a historic moment. Everyone should participate. Secondly, they have not contacted even people that they are with. They have not taken Yashwant Sinha. One second, please. Charanjit, I don't think we need to interrupt each other. You have not even taken Yashwant Sinha to West Bengal. He's from TMC. You have not been able to convince your own people. So don't blame us. And if you think any agency or democracy has been throttled, I request Rahul to increase the time of the debate for 5 minutes. Charanjit can call up Hemant Soren right now during the debate and ask him what pressures he was facing because of which he has changed his vote to Draupadi Murmuji. I ask him open challenge.
No, but there's a bigger problem. If Mamata Banerjee doesn't even invite Yashwant Sinha to come in campaign in West Bengal, despite Yashwant being a TMC nominee before he became the opposition's choice for president, that says a lot about the kind of people that you're picking. Rajdeep made an important point. Pick somebody whose civil society will be rallied by. Somebody who says, okay, here is somebody who represents a secular, different idea of India from the idea that's being pushed by the BJP, by Prime Minister Modi and by the RSS. You couldn't even do that basic thing. You picked somebody who was actually a long-time BJP member. Mr. Sapra?
I think silence is the best answer.
Yeah. I got it. No, see, this is one part where you can, you know, you can choose your words to say all this thing. But Congress and the opposition parties, they have taken a collective decision. And looking at the current scenario, they have taken this decision. I feel in the current scenario, Yashwant Sinha was the best candidate. You can always give examples. Even if I can give example that Uddhav Sena, they are not voting for the presidential candidate and they'll be voting for the vice presidential candidate, Margaret Alva. So there are similar cases in the past also. There'll be such cases in the future also. I feel 2024 will be a different election. There will be a different scenario, and definitely Congress as the principal opposition party will have an upper hand, and different strategies will be worked out.
Rajdeep and Rahul Srivastava will be worked out collectively by the opposition parties. It's a different election. We'll work out modalities with other opposition parties. It's a different context. Is it, according to you, so different, or it's really a continuation of what we are seeing right now? If they can't pick a candidate together, how will they pick candidates in 543 seats?
Look, I don't think, Rahul, we are ever going to have a Lok Sabha election where you will have 543 opposition candidates in a one-on-one fight with the BJP. I don't think that's going to happen. If the opposition or anyone believes that would happen, I think they're living in a fool's paradise. Across this country, there are so many sharp divisions that exist on the ground between a Mamata and the Congress in Bengal, between the TRS and the Congress in Telangana. These differences between the JMM to some extent and the Congress in Jharkhand, there are differences on the ground. Therefore, 543 candidates to be elected. The Aam Aadmi Party, another X factor, they want to also occupy the space. I think the real question, and I've raised this a few months ago as well, kaun banega principal opposition? That is a question that first needs to be addressed. You know, we took it for granted until now that only the Congress can be the principal opposition because the Congress's footprint is much larger than any other party. But as we are seeing, there are several states where there are enough opposition parties that will challenge that narrative of the Congress being the principal narrative. And until that issue is settled, how the opposition intends to provide a united front leading up to 2024 is a big question mark. They first need a narrative. They first need a narrative and idea to challenge the BJP. I agree to some extent with Shehzad that the opposition's only narrative has been anti-Modism. That, you know, this obsession with Mr. Modi cannot be the sole reason to bring the opposition together. This is not, much as the opposition would like to tell you, not 1977. This is not that emergency mindset. There you had a Jayaprakash Narayan. There you were able to have leaders of stature within the opposition who could come together on one platform, the likes of Mr. Chandrasekhar, the likes of Morarji Desai, Jagjeevan Ram. The list was endless. Today, the opposition doesn't have those kind of tall leaders who can actually come to the on one platform, both within the Congress and even outside it. So you're going to see a churning, I believe, within the opposition leading up to 2024. And I believe eventually this may well be settled in only in 2029. Because it will take that much time before the opposition actually is able to throw up a great new idea that can challenge in a way what the BJP represents or what Mr. Modi represents. It's not just Mr. Modi the individual, it's about the idea that he and the BJP represent that the opposition have to provide a counter narrative to make themselves attractive.
Rahul Srivastav, kaun banega principal opposition? Earlier the Congress seemed the likely shoo-in, now that seems disputable. Who do you think is likely to be the answer to that question that Rajdeep poses?
See, Rahul, if you analyze, Congress is still the only next to BJP pan-national party. There is no doubt about it. But when Congress says that the BJP has eaten up Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, no, Rahul, it is the Congress is doing. The Mamata Banerjee ate up the Congress. She was a Congress person. YSRCP ate up the Congress. That was Congress. When did you hear a senior Congress leader in Odisha, after J.B. Patnaik or Girdhar Gabang, have you heard of any Congress leader? No, they have not created leaders. They have lost leaders. The Congress's crisis has started long time back. The Congress hasn't addressed it. Now, the problem for the Congress and the opposition is that the Congress's decline is leading to new startups. Mamata Banerjee in Bengal, Arvind Kejriwal, who has now gone unicorn with Punjab. The problem is that these are what Rajdeep is mentioning. That there were strong leaders. There is no Jayaprakash Narayan to bring them together. There is no strong reason for their coming together. And there are runaway ambitions right now, Rahul, which will not allow this opposition to come together. How can a leadership emerge when everybody is an equal claimant in a pie? Mamata Banerjee pushes Yashwant Sinha to emerge as a principal opposition. Sharad Pawar is playing the role of the man behind the curtains controlling the opposition. Rahul, it's not working out. The problem is, as Shehzad said, I agree, anti-BJP is where anti-Modiism gives you mileage in newspapers and television channels. It does not create cadres and a movement against a leader. And that is why the leadership issue needs to be addressed by the opposition. Otherwise, 2024, Narendra Modi has to make a big mistake to lose it. Otherwise, it's game over.
But that's the problem with the Congress's approach. They're waiting for Modi and Shah and the BJP to make mistakes rather than trying to fashion a strategy of their own. And you can't build a party and a cadre sitting in Spain or wherever else some of these leaders have been holidaying. I want to wrap up this discussion. It doesn't bode well for the opposition challenge. And as a political journalist and as an analyst, all you want is a good fight. Doesn't matter who wins, nothing really turns for us. You want a good fight between equals, a barabar ki kushti, not this heavyweight sumo wrestler on the one side up against a piddi pehlwan, and it's just a one-way traffic. That's no fun, not even to report on, not to track. You need the opposition. Come on, Mr. Sapra, give it your best. And
if I may just sum up. Yeah. I would just suggest to my dear friend Charanji that more than focusing on position, ambition and television, try learning vision and mission from Narendra Modi ji, and perhaps you will not do pindadan of your opposition unity, like Maddan is over, but today it is pindadan of your opposition unity led by Congress.
If you have a counter as good as that, give it back. Charan Singh Sapra, go for it.
See, in 2004 also, all the debates were going in this way only when we were talking about shining India. And even the BJP spokesperson were exaggerating on all the debates. But what happened? We won the election and nobody knew that Dr. Manmohan Singh will become the Prime Minister. So the same situation is there now. I feel the opposition collectively will come over it. And also you will see a good face which will represent the opposition party and who's going to challenge the BJP and Narendra Modi.
Okay, we'll see what happens. It's not looking like a very feisty election just at this moment, but it could come down to one big mistake. But are Messrs. Modi and Shah too astute? Because even when they make a mistake, they dial back very quickly. They don't let that mistake snowball. And that again is a big challenge. Anyway, it's an unequal fight, this. You've got really relentless, intense boxers on the one side versus others who question whether they want to be boxing at all. And these kind of battles typically end just one way. To my guests, Shehzad Poonawalla, Charan Singh Sapra, Rashid Kidwai, Rajdeep Sardesai and Rahul Srivastav, for joining me on the Newstrack for your sharp political insights. Thank you very much. I'm slipping into a break. I'll have more for you when I come back on the other side. Stay with us. Back in the
कैसा रहा दिन?
बहुत अच्छा।
कोई वीडियो गेम कवर करने गई थी ना?
वीडियो गेम नहीं माँ, ई-स्पोर्ट्स।
ई-स्पोर्ट्स?
माँ, ई-स्पोर्ट्स is just like any other competitive sport. इसमें ना वो सब फीलिंग्स है जो किसी भी और स्पोर्ट्स में है। इसमें इमोशन है, इसमें एंगर है, इसमें सैडनेस है, इसमें हैप्पीनेस है, इसमें कमराडरी है। ये सिर्फ गेम नहीं, ये ई-स्पोर्ट्स का प्रीमियर लीग ESPL है।
Listening to music puts you in a good mood, but have you ever heard of music that gets you high? In a never-ending quest to get high or feel better, people are listening to binaural beats to mellow their minds. A study shows that many have been trying binaural beats as a form of therapy or even an intoxicant. The term binaural means two sounds, and binaural recording without the beats refers to a kind of stereo recording wherein the listener feels totally surrounded by the musicians. Everyday sounds range from 250 to about 6000 Hz. Binaural beats are usually below 1000 Hz, which is in the low range of average human hearing. Hector Orozco Perez, an author of a recent study on the mysterious beats, puts it this way. What happens is when you listen to two pure tones separated into each other, the tiny difference causes a frequency mismatch as the sound travels to the auditory part of your brainstem. Simply put, if your right ear is hearing 260 Hz and your left ear is hearing 250 Hz, then your binaural beat comes in around 10 Hz. What makes binaural beats interesting is the ability to synchronize or entrain your brain's electrical response to adhere to a certain rhythm, and rhythmic stimuli can help people concentrate. There are several types of beats. Delta is the lowest frequency, just 0.5 to 4 Hz. Next is theta, between 4 and 7 Hz. Alpha beats range from 7 to 13.
The latest cover of India Today magazine has triggered a big war between southern superstar fans. Allu Arjun represents the South swag in the latest issue of India Today magazine, but this has got Prabhas's fans up in arms. Prabhas was on the cover in 2017 when Bahubali broke all box office records. Here's more on the viral cover war.
The superstar of superstars is setting the internet on fire, and how. These hearts and fire emojis on his India Today magazine cover are all a proof of how much craze the Pushpa actor has instilled in his fans' hearts, not just in India, but across the globe. That's right. This July issue featuring Allu Arjun is creating waves across social media. It has already garnered over 8 lakh likes and more than 6,000 comments, clearly indicating he is here to stay. Interestingly, Allu Arjun is also making headlines for another good reason. After the mega success of his mass entertainer Pushpa The Rise, it's now the album of the film that has set a new record with over 500 crore views to become the first pan-India film to achieve this feat.
नाव में बैठकर जाल फेंकना बहुत आसान है। पानी में उतरेगा तो बड़ी मछलियां खा जाएंगी।
तेरी झलक शर्फी श्रीवल्ली नैना मदक बर्फी। तेरी झलक
From hook step, that became a worldwide sensation to dialogue delivery that marched into every household.
Pushpa naam sunke flower samjhe kya? Flower nahi. Fire.
His uber-cool performance and swag written all over his screen presence was all it took for Allu Arjun to become the icon star that he is today.
Hey, ye kya kar raha hai tu? Pair pe pair rakhe baitha hai, malik bhadak raha hai. Kuch to izzat kar.
Kai jalo? Ye apun ka pair hai. Ye dusra wala bhi apun ka pair hai. Tu uski lungi mein mirchi kai ko lag rahi hai? Usko bol kaam dekh, daag mat dekh. Mero kaam ke paise deta hai ki izzat dene ke?
Yes, with Pushpa the rise, the superstar certainly ticked all the boxes to effortlessly be tagged as the quintessential poster boy of Indian cinema.
Sab apni ladai lad rahe.
But all he and writer-director Sukumaran had wanted to do was make a Telugu entertainer.
Pushpa, Pushpa Raj, main jhukega nahi sala.
Allu Arjun revealed this and much more to India Today magazine as he turned cover boy for the July issue, which is now on the stands. Born and brought up in Chennai, the Allu family moved to Hyderabad only in the year 2000. Not many know that Arjun's grandfather, Allu Ramalingayya, was a farmer turned actor who appeared in over 1,000 films and was known for his roles as a comedian. Allu Arjun started off his own cinematic journey in 2003 with Gangotri. But he rose to prominence with cult classic Arya in 2004, an eponymous film directed by Sukumar, who actually took notice of Allu Arjun when he was 20 years old. The filmmaker was convinced this film would go on to make him popular even in Kerala, where he's known as Mallu Arjun and has multiple fan clubs. What's more, in a career spanning almost two decades, Allu Arjun, apart from Pushpa the Rise, has given hits including 2009's Arya 2, 2015's Rudrama Devi, and 2020's Ala Vaikuntha Paramulu. That's not all. In a film industry teeming with stars such as Prabhas, Mahesh Babu, Ram Charan, Junior NTR, Pawan Kalyan, Nani, and legends like Chiranjeevi and Nagarjun, Allu Arjun is also known as the stylish star, courtesy his urban swag and dancing prowess, which is also evident in viral songs like Butta Bamma from Ala Vaikuntha Puramalu. While what's missing in Allu Arjun's illustrious filmography to date is a collaboration with India's most celebrated pop epicist, S.S. Rajamouli. He is now gearing up for the sequel of his blockbuster film Pushpa, The Rise. For now, get your copies of India Today magazine, July issue, to meet your favorite superstar Allu Arjun, and meanwhile take a look at this behind-the-scenes photo shoot with him. With Dipali Patel, Entertainment Bureau, India Today.
This is where I wrap up the news track tonight. For your time and your trust, thank you very much. I look forward to seeing you at 8 p.m. tomorrow evening. Till then, from all of us here, goodbye, good night.
जब हम आपके लिए एक न्यूज शो बनाते हैं तो उसकी टीम भी एक ऑर्केस्ट्रा की तरह होती है, ठीक इस पियानो की तरह। अगर उसमें एक भी म्यूजिकल नोट गलत हो जाए तो पूरा स्वर बेसुरा हो जाता है, जो आपको अच्छा नहीं लगेगा। वैसे इसी पियानो में मेरे नए शो का नाम भी छिपा हुआ है, ये आपके लिए एक हिंट है।
सही गेस करने वाले पहले 1000 दर्शकों को मिलेगा ₹1000 कैश प्राइज जीतने का मौका। तो अपना जवाब अभी WhatsApp कीजिए 8657900895 पर।
Russia has defaulted on its sovereign debt. Moscow owes about $40 billion of sovereign bonds. Have the global sanctions now finally caught up? Is Russia in trouble, or does it still have friends when it comes to handling its economy? The foreign assets and foreign currency that have been frozen by the international bodies is a grave concern for Russia, given that even if Russia wants to make the payments, it really cannot. This sanction regime, or the sanctions that have been placed against Russia, with Russia now defaulting, is a grim reminder of the political outcast it once had become and is now on the way to becoming. But is it? While the West wants to isolate Russia, there are still many countries who are standing by Moscow and are engaging Russia. So is it real trouble for Russia? Or will Russia see through this crisis as well as it did in the 90s? Now, with the economy and finances at stake, how severe are the damages? Now, Russia had $640 billion in foreign currency and gold reserves held overseas. Russia owes $40 billion in sovereign bonds and half of it to foreigners. That's the part that has been defaulted this year, and it is a historic moment nonetheless. Having said that, the last time Russia defaulted was after the breakup of the Soviet Union. It also defaulted on domestic bonds in late 1990s, but recovered very soon after. Investors across the world were monitoring what is happening to Russia and what is becoming of the situation vis-a-vis the West. They were monitoring the global sanctions and therefore anticipated the default that now is to be. This is a huge setback for Russia, since Russia has not defaulted in so many years, and now with this default, they are going to be out or cut off from the bond borrowing market until they pay their dues. Now, even before the sanctions came about, Russia knew that it was due to make those payments of the sovereign debt, and therefore they offered to pay in rubles, but the West refused to take that payment. And that's the reason why Russia today is in a position of not being able to service those dues.
Everyone's busy finding what's trending. You're busy finding out why. India Today, for those who research before reacting. Download the India Today app now. Make your media plan smarter with India Today Live TV on your connected devices.
You are watching